Welcome to the Green Ring, and thanks for watching. This video is second in a series of eight presenting a note-by-note analysis of Wagner's Das Rheingold Scene 2. Built on nearly two centuries of scholarly literature, its massive journey aspires to scan the entirety of Der Ring des Nibelungen to its final note. I'll hope you take this voyage with me, one I'm dedicated to completing. For an explanation of who I am and more on the reasons for this series, please check out my preface video. Its link is supplied below, along with those for the other videos preceding this one. We pick up where we left off in Dover's full score, the first stave of page 94, the nub of Wotan's defense against Fricka's complaints about his cupidity, which he sets forth by means of a cogent syntactic bouquet. Valhalla Part 1's variant links to a truncation of Part 3 to conclude after its own world-ash interval in a unique modification of Valhalla Part 4, the Valhalla Cadence. All that morpheme's parts are in play, the spear base, world-ash interval, and the developing Freya syntax born of Alberich's frustration. The unusual detail, its world-ash interval, originally a rising octave, here sounds a reassuring sixth, one of those minor details which in time acquires huge importance. Additionally, beneath the Freya syntax, the static Valhalla interval sounds on third trumpet first tenor trombone, without the giant thump heard earlier. In other words, freed from its natural control. The god's vocal is equally instructive. He intones three ash intervals in succession, the first static, the last two inverted, the third to oppose Valhalla Part 3's high interval in brass,
his inversion fortified by another in contrabass tuba.
All three of Wotan's intervals are the module's equivocal forms, but the central one brings the most ominous information by falling an octave, reversing with sharp emphasis the low-ash interval he's only just intoned on a rising octave in the midst of singing the domestic bliss syntax. Wotan finishes by distorting the Freya morpheme with an out-of-place triplet, which outlines reverse melody notes, one he caps with chord notes. Within only a few moments' time, the passage includes
nine
complete statements of the world-ash interval in most all its guises, a remarkably dense bouquet which leaves no question that the mighty tree's energy locked in Valhalla empowers the immortal to defy his marital duties to his spouse. Additionally, the ash interval's more positive incarnations are reserved for the orchestral invocation of Valhalla, while his vocal sounds only its compromised versions. This deepens the suspicion first aroused by Fricka's very different idea of Valhalla, as do the racially charged reverse air-to-melody notes, this one portion of his vocal hiding within it Flosshilda's heroic cell. The implication is that Wotan hasn't been sexually faithful and, as part and parcel with his larger plans for dominating the world, he means to persist in cheating on Fricka. At first blush, an audience is likely to take this reference to Vandal and Veschel as meaning only Wotan's world rule through brute force. It also echoes the famous Ricka letter, and Fricka immediately addresses that point. The string choir shoulders aside brass in a rising tonic fanfare modeled on the Valhalla Part 1 variant,
launched with a telltale double impact soon to acquire syntactic weight of its own, then move through a high-ash interval,
its last notes distorted by flattening what would otherwise be a rising triad of treachery and betrayal. This expresses his consort's outraged resistance to the god's latest affront, which he voices in starkly bitter terms, Liebloser, Leidigste, to an inverted ash interval shaped by a Welter triad, with its developing syntactic charge of racial change.
She
caps it with a rising fourth to give it a feel of the Rheinbeten's fecklessness as well, then sinks on another fourth into reverse chord notes, as Valhalla's triple time reverts to common. Fricka's vocal, as it falls to reverse the introductory fanfare's rise, also constitutes a subtle foreshadowing of another crucial reversal, air to twilight.
After a quaver rest, she continues by rising a third into
reversed melody note shaped by yet another inverted ash interval, She continues on Albrecht's Rhinebeaten-like turn, this one's ending reversed with an ironic falling third as she indicts Macht und Herrschaft müssen Tand. After static notes, she rises on melody notes as she impeaches his lästerndem Spott in having gambled away Liebe und Weibeswert, a passage that triggers one of the epic's crucial syntactic evolutions. Strings intone renunciation's distinctive central figure as contrabass pedal emphasizes its air to chord notes. Fricka's vocal begins on a falling air to fourth, moves through a low ash interval on a pathetic rising sixth, then echoes the reversed melody notes of renunciation. Spencer Millington and Sabor recognize the reversed melody notes of renunciation, but alone among commentators, Cook identifies this latest incarnation not as renunciation of love, but the embryonic development from that morpheme of new syntax, whose genesis Loge completes when launching his panegyric to nature. Though Cook declines to assign it a name, since it appears so frequently throughout the tetralogy in the form of a falling scale alone, while the more complex renunciation morpheme returns whole at a few select moments, this analysis refers to the new module as resignation. Its reversed melody notes already flavor much of Albrecht's frustrated wooing,
then gain huge importance as Valkyr concludes
to cast a longer shadow over the epic's remainder, a detail saved for discussion as its instances occur. For now, as confirmed by Fricka's plaint, which initiates it, resignation is closely related to Wotan's lust for unbridled sexual power, underlined on the spot as the spear follows it on low strings, its descent echoing the emergent resignation pulse in Fricka's voice, suggesting the two morphemes' conceptual relationship. Atop the spear morpheme, Wotan defensively sings another low ash interval on a fourth, only to contradict its positive effect after static notes with a dire falling octave, from which he attempts to recover in a bold rising fifth. But his second low interval on reverse chord notes is finished by a dire plunging fifth, making the whole a bouquet of power fragments strung with two of the work's most ominous anti-heroic and tragic intervals. He finishes his thought on that rising triad, whose frivolous unconcern further attaches itself to the idea of abandonment, after which he slides back down reverse melody notes with their nation's sense of racial conquest. The Spencer Millington translation is slightly more exact than Porter. In order to win you as wife, my one remaining eye, I state that I might woo you. Shaw opines, this has brought to Wotan as Fricka's dowry all the powers of law. Following this dictum's lasting effect in even the most recent analyses, Cook judges Fricka by its standard, though basing his argument primarily on her
Valkyrie
behavior. Fricka, with her righteous concern for the sanctity of marriages, including her own, with her wifely possessiveness, contentiousness, and jealousy, enshrines her husband's conservative conscience, his rigid superego ideals, from which he is trying to break free. Cook then relates this to the events of Rheingold. She is appalled at Wotan's disregard for law in striking the fraudulent contract with the giants. But Fricka's actual words, never mind the syntax around them, imply her concern isn't at all for the bargain's legality. Rather, she's upset over its loveless disregard for her sister Freya, and women in general. Far from defending the rule of law, meaning the kind of power after which her menfolk lust, or her own wounded marriage, something which comes later after the god so blatantly ruptures it, Fricka instead argues eloquently for the rule of love. It's Wotan alone who etches the law runes into his spear, a deed as much his idea as is stealing from nature the power to enforce those rules, meaning from the world ash. Fricka's dowry, therefore, isn't the rule of law, but another unique aspect of natural energy, her sister Freya with her magic apples, thanks to which the gods enjoy eternal life. Thus, like her sister, Fricka is an elemental force of nature, which, throughout Rheingold, is the voice of reason, moderation, and affection, which defends the sanctity of the individual against Wotan's dictatorial power dealings, whether lawful or not, that shun love and destroy personal autonomy. This brighter world, Fricka asks of Wotan, as embodied in her rejected version for his castle, is a paradise dedicated to nurture rather than conquest, one presided over by the twin ideals of fertility, Freya, and mutual empathy, Fricka. In this light, Fricka and Freya are Erda's first attempt to mitigate, even halt, and heal Wotan's chronic offenses against their natural world. Wotan frustrates all three women by deliberately excluding the goddesses in Valhalla from his bargaining table, ensuring an entirely more brutal type of citadel is built, one that comes at a higher, indeed an inconceivably fearful price. In barring Fricka and her sister Freya from negotiations, he throws himself open to Loge's subversive influence, who is Erda's contingency plan. This leaves her atavistic god with a grim expedient who is too blinded by his own power lust to see through her trap. Wotan's previous vocal brings up another controversy which should be laid to rest. Newman believes the god's comment, pledging an eye to win Fricka, conflicts with what he believes is the Norn's Götterdämmerung revelation that the pledge is for his drink of wisdom alone, making Wotan's Rheingold comment a revision error. With a footnote wrestling the matter, Spencer Millington altered their translation on the strength of Wagner's 1852 prose draft. But there's a simpler explanation, which better reconciles the overall narrative. Wotan gives up his eye for a drink at the Norn Spring in order to win Fricka, nothing more. Resting his spear lies outside that original bargain, as confirmed by the whole of his exchange with Fricka, the spear joined to an unbroken chain of power syntax in his vocal. This concludes with the mark of abandonment and its racial prerogative, sacrificing love itself. Added to the mix, his phrase concludes on four descending scalar notes drawn from that reversal of the Erda melody, which blossoms throughout the tetralogy into an important module that embodies Wotan's doomed grab for racial supremacy. Supporting the bundle, strings intone a self-satisfied full major mode cadence, ironically shaped as the reverse chord notes born of Alberich's fated wooing. The god relinquishes his eye, not for love, but the power he expects to wield by spawning a new breed. He'll rule them from Valhalla with his ill-gotten spear, a scheme developed in
Valkyr,
fulfilled in Siegfried, and destroyed in Götterdämmerung. Strings contradict the previous cadence with Erda chords, ended by a quaver sting, as Wotan, beginning on chord notes, chides his consort as törish to a rising fifth and ring fragment,
its embryonic sexual connotations lurking just beneath the surface.
He continues on the heroic resistance module to fall a sixth, and after static notes, a plunging Erda fourth and reverse Erda chord notes, throwing in his consort's face a bone of contention which, by the time of
Valkyr,
festers into their total breach. Erisch die Frauen doch mehr als dich freut. It's a potent hint that, in the way of sundry mythological deities, this god's already engaged in enough extramarital affairs to alienate Fricka, a notion reinforced by her vain hope of Valhalla as assurance of his fidelity. The string choir responds angrily with a rising series of two brush opposing Erda chord note turns, followed by one distortion, all on triplet semiquavers, which ascend in the crib of the rising triad, a picture of Fricka's mute outrage at her consort's betrayals. Wagner's comments to Roeckel, quoted previously, suggest the god's bond is loveless because Wotan's grown out of it, Somas Sieg, Wandel und Wechsel. This no doubt reflects the Meister's personal problems at the time, meaning his intense frustrations with his wife Minna, alongside his dalliances with Jessie Lausseau and Mathilde Wessendonck. but it raises a specter with immense significance for the tale's far-reaching aims, a nod to Votan's carnal lusts, which only proves Fricka's point. Still, the god tops his dismissal a cappella by insisting he wouldn't think of giving up Freya, rising a heroic fifth to fall a third as he sings her name, after which he calls her Die Gute on chord notes, only to contradict his benevolent intentions by singing a reversal of the extended melody notes, that four-note phrase only just allied to his racial aspirations, whose punctuation is a single rapid erdachord pulse in strings. Fricka and Erda shuddering together. He concludes vocally on a longer spear-like scale, which he caps with a rising fifth to make its finish the heroic module, all part of the growing dichotomy between the worldviews of god and consort that finally expands the ring cosmos into a terrible, power-laden jungle, far darker than Fricka's Rheingold fears. Critics protest the Rheingold music has a Lohengrin-like simplicity, verging on barrenness, that only exacerbates its chilly dramatic content. After Scene 1's lush sensuality and Valhalla's noble launch, Scene 2's Votan Fricka dialogue does leave the ear a bit starved. But Rheingold's austerity is leavened with opulence, its formal quasi-recitative arguments and exchanges contrasted with and heightened by the riches lavished on its many hymns to the natural order. During passages when the narrative's environmental thesis shakes off the anti-natural yoke of schemes and double dealing, the orchestra presses towards the later opera's oral fertility. On the surface, this appears to follow the Meister's self-appointed rules from opera and drama, but the underlying factor is purely narrative-driven by the work's resonances with nature. The Votan Fricka dialogue naturally doesn't catch fire until Freya is glimpsed in the distance, fleeing the giants, meaning once forces reappear that portray nature struggling to venerate love. In the mythology, Freya is never in peril since the apples of immortality aren't her business, a role played by the goddess Iduna, whom Wagner concatenates into his Freya. The mythic Loki tricks Iduna into leaving Asgard with her apples to be abducted by the giant Thiassi. The Eddic tale gives no more reason for this rape than Thiassi, like all the myth's giants, is an enemy of the gods. Thiassi's only motive seems to be destroying the immortals by theft of their eternal youth, without which, crippled by age, they have only Loki to fall back on. They force him to act, who takes the shape of a falcon, transforms the goddess into a nut, then, with it in his claw, flies to Asgard, Thiassi in hot pursuit as an eagle. Burning away the giant's wings with fires that protect the citadels, the gods beat Thiassi to death. None of this was of any use to Wagner beyond the idea of Freya pursued by giants, although his Loge is guilty by association for putting into the gods' minds the idea of Freya as payment for Valhalla. The moment Votan insists he wouldn't think of abandoning Freya, Fricka notices her sister's offstage peril. With the key change to E minor, the meter takes a brisker alla breve. Sustained by woodwind horn cording that rises by minim thirds to outline a reversed ring fragment, the string choir follows suit at a parallax in a hasty group of four erdachords, which, at the top, become a pair of reversals. At the peak of their ascent, flutes cry erdachords, ending on a woodwind minim quaver chord as violins, violas surge up quavers fingered in semi-quavers. Woodwinds race down in a minor mode quaver arpeggiation as strings fall on chord notes, then thirds, the whole rising-falling sign another embryonic foreshadowing of Erda Twilight. Over violin-viola tremolos, Fricka warns her spouse the time has come to make good his word, her initial static vocal notes falling a tritone, followed by reverse chord notes, then, after a quaver rest, melody notes terminated with biting irony by the Rhine maiden's frivolous inverted triad turn. At this point, the love goddess is meant to rush on stage, attended by what, not surprisingly, is one of the epic's most important syntactic bundles. Like several of the work's pivotal morphemes, this one is often misunderstood, much of the blame for which must be laid at Voltzogen's door. He grasps its initial rising arpeggio, as specific to Freya herself, but dubs its falling conclusion as flight, justifying it as a new and significant symbol of the god's distress, which begins here and increases throughout all the dramas. Kobe accepts this as a given, though the 1908 shot vocal score prefers angst. Newman doubts the wisdom of calling this segment by any such terms, but, unable to puzzle out its meaning, dismisses it as a musical tick into which Wagner was inclined to fall on various occasions, sometimes, as here, with a specific purpose, sometimes without any. Hutchison takes Voltzogen at his word, so it's not until Cook this mystery is clarified. Holman agrees with Cook, though cites its entirety as love without any mention of Freya, while Donington distinguishes the two segments, then attempts to honor both traditions by calling its final portion agitation, but including both passion and compassion. Sabor cuts this Gordian knot by, like Cook, dubbing the entirety simply Freya. Yet, in the way of Voltzogen and Kobe, he doesn't seem to register these first hectic iterations are anomalous, only meant to portray the goddess in her current and temporary distress. The syntax only sounds with this degree of urgency once more during Rheingold, and the last time in
Valkyrie,
instances discussed in their time. Cook's rationale, the most correct, is emphasized by the fact that, after Rheingold, the morpheme infrequently recurs with both modules sounding one after the other, but mostly separated, so each may invoke its own unique association. This appearance of the syntax, like the Rheingold fanfare, all Valhalla segments, the spear, and so forth, is a direct violation of opera and drama, written immediately before Rheingold, in that the orchestra introduces a critical motif without any words directly aligned with it as a vocal melody that might pinpoint its meaning. Yet Wagner realized an onstage image of Gold Fortress, Wotan's weapon, and in the present case Freya in the flesh, would do more to implant solid associations in an audience's mind than would, as the saying goes, a thousand words. Much in Rheingold suggests the Meister groping towards a stylistic sea change, which only comes into its own with
Valkyrie.
With that in mind, Newman calling Freya's second module a Wagnerian tick isn't out of place, in that Wagner seems to hammer out the work's syntax as it must have come to him on the fly and in many ways subconsciously. A plethora of nascent syntax emerges in Scene 1 and Scene 2, which congeals over time into more definitive modules, and this Freya syntax is no exception. The love goddess's initial cry for help, a static ash interval followed by a dire plunging fifth, triggers octavo-low strings to rise in a quasi-erta melody shape, answered by first violins, then high woodwinds, with quasi-ring fragments. The goddess's next appeal begins on a falling triad, her fear that the approaching giants come for a sexual partner, a phrase she ends on plaintive chord notes, again inspiring the Erda Twilight-like melody-ring fragment combination. Winds, with a trio of sforzando string chords, two semibrevi, one minim, Freya describes Fasolt in the distance, threatening her as she sings a static ash interval, finished by a dire plunging octave, another static interval, several bounces on thirds, then a chord note turn, and plunging tritone. Under that last threatening interval, low strings pulse two giant thumps, who are the Vala's creatures, of course, elemental forces of nature like Freya herself, which explains the erta melody distortion surrounding her cries. The ring fragments pose a deeper mystery, which gropes towards more clarity during Scene 3. That secret, however, is intimated from the start, in that Voglinda's lyric when she first introduces the ring defines its central power as Welterbe. that such a power should manifest itself as sexual racial reproduction should surprise no one familiar with the Meister's famed prejudices. Despite that, the form it takes in the ring, at least per this analysis, is bound to be one of its most controversial assertions.
As a side note, the opposition of falling rising octaves has already begun to suggest lust for interracial breeding in Alberich, while bouncing thirds have and will continue to subtly assist in expressions of vitality.
It comes as no surprise, then, after a second low-string giant thump, Votan dismisses the Titan's threat to another falling triad, then wanders after Loge by leaping up from static notes on an air to fourth to plunge a tritone, his vocal initiating a rising series of five first violin reverse chord note figures, harsh punctuation over second violin viola tremolos, as Fricka heaps scorn upon her husband's trust in the fire god. These reverse chord note figures border Freya's entrance like bookends, but never return after Fricka's brief scolding, her vocal begun on a static ash interval, capped by a plunging fifth. She continues through static notes into air to chord notes,
then lifts a third into Flosshilda's heroic figure, capped in a tritone. After a quaver rest, she rises a third into a falling triad to mock Votan's, followed by chagrin, which she terminates with another ominous downward fifth. She finishes after a crotchet rest and virtually a cappella, rising yet another tritone into melody notes, rounded by that Rhine Maiden bounce, recalling the one with which she introduces Freya's morphine, here finished in bouncing air to fourths. Syntactically, then, Fricka's latest scold closely identifies the fire god with both Erda and the Rhine Maidens.
A calmly dignified string figure prefaces the god's defense, which, distinctive as it is, never repeats, while twice following the long-short-long rhythm of ring DNA,
and concealing a sly abandonment triad.
Vocally defending his Freier Mut, Votan begins with a crib of Freya's module, ending in a tritone's bite, obscured by the warm string harmonies, to continue after rising a third with another more distorted version of
the Freya morpheme,
its falling interval another plunging tritone, which he concludes with an inverted ash interval capped in an ominous descending fifth. During a dotted crotchet rest to separate the god from his following disclaimer, the strings give a single pulse of Valhalla Part 1, floating over string chords guided in Viola's cellos by a subtle reverse air to melody note pulse, he states he relies on the fire god only against Findus Neid, his voice rising from static notes on reverse air to chord notes to fall a third. Following a quaver pause, he then sinks on chord notes into a high ash interval on a sixth, itself capped by chord notes, triggering a brief passage which helps unlock one of the work's deep-laid mysteries. Votan sings a pair of closely echoing lines, the first built on a rising tritone and a falling triad, the second launched by air to chord notes and a heroic rising fifth, to conclude on another descending triad. The first ends on air to chord notes, which also bracket the second. These two mirroring lines vaguely, though unsurprisingly, hint at one of Loge's modules, but the really intriguing details reside in the god's string accompaniment. Its cello bass marches slowly down a quasi-spear scale in an unbroken chromatic scale, while viola chords follow its movement as they underline the god's first phrase by twice gradually and chromatically sliding from major to minor, then back again, the telltale sign of Erda's influence here subtly doubled in power. The revelation comes when they support Votan's second phrase, pinpointing Loge's power, with a tantalizing foretaste of magic sleep, complete with its reverse melody notes. Cook acknowledges the genesis of the important sleep morpheme in the fire god's chromatic language, without further comment on its corollaries. There is a great deal more to be said, of course, for additional hints of magic sleep resurface throughout Rheingold. The key takeaway at this moment, however, is the link forged here between Freya's plight, Votan's predicament, Loge's influence over it, and Erda's covert dreaming shadow across the entire affair. The god goes on to tell what neither Fricka nor an audience yet know, which is that Loge has promised a ransom for Freya. Atop a pair of string crotchets, on each measure's downbeat, his vocal is virtually a cappella at first as it rises on melody notes into the Rhine Maiden bounce with its own falling triad, this time with an Erda fourth ascent. Then, after a quaver rest in static notes, he falls another fourth to rise a third into a fascinating embryonic distortion, supported reassuringly by a string semibreve of Freya's second module, complete with wanted chord note finish. The entire string choir marches up quavers in a pizzicato major arpeggio, including the inevitable triad, a figure about to acquire great significance for the giants, never mind the gods' ongoing abandonment of love as epitomized by its tutelary goddess. Votan concludes virtually a cappella, affirming his faith in Loge with the rising fourth, the melody's final heroic notes in retrograde, finished on the melody notes and a downward fifth to outline chagrin. After all, the god doesn't yet have any idea how he's going to make good on this brash promise. Despite the immortal's revealing bravado, the crisis is at hand. With an initial pair of reverse Erda chord notes, semiquaver strings rise on a nervous chromatic scale as Fricka cries the fire god has abandoned his friend, leaping up a fourth and a fifth,
essentially a rising octave of natural power, split across two of harmony's stoutest intervals. She thus rises
into that figure introduced by Alberich in his scene one wooing, and subtly recurring since then as a mark of harsh resistance, only recently made explicit by Fricka herself. She points out the giants have nearly arrived. Her first vocals group of two static ash intervals ended with a falling seventh, her second phrase rising in Erda fourth to fall a poignant sixth, and conclude with a crib of Flosshilda's heroic figure, which, paradoxically yet with developing import, is a kind of retrograde bulwark against Alberich's figure as solidified in Fricka's own resistance to her consort's treatment of Freya. As she sings, bowed on tremolo second violin's violas, graced marcato horn crotchets punctuate timpani giant thumps, themselves graced with Valhalla ash intervals, roughly aligned with Fricka's static intervals. Under these, low strings rise on a pair of quasi-Erda melodies, each pulse capped in first violin semiquaver Rhine Maiden bounces. This chaos triggers horns to leap up octavo on an Erda fourth into the continuous second violin viola tremolo chording, which supports the desperate clarity of first violins,
naturally enough completing their second Rhine Maiden bounce as they intone the next potential rape victim's syntax.
A partial Freya pulse, its rising arpeggio followed only by two strophes of its sinking module. Calling on her brothers for help, the goddess's despairing vocal adds a weird, unsyncopated shadow of the dwarf's earlier wooing, capped by chord notes. First violin's echo, developing the turn module into a distinctively plaintive one, built from chord notes, followed by melody notes, the whole a suggestion of the giant turn. Violins fall on an arpeggio as her desperate cry intones a truncated iteration of the dwarf's earlier frustrated wooing that's transitioned into Fricka's outrage over her sister's ill-treatment. Freya caps this with more chord notes as tremolo second violins outline more slowly the first's new-minted turn, her vocal passing through static notes to bounce down and up on fifths, a phrase she caps with her own module, heightening its strange echo of Alberich's woe, never mind its presence in the Valhalla syntax. Freya's cries trigger first violins in another pulse of her initial cell, this time eschewing its second module by instead repeating at the top the giant-like turn, as she cries for help to a rising Erda fourth, whose chord note finish roughly synchronizes with those in the first violin line. This Tern cell, it should be noted, seems especially prominent as the giants approach to claim their imagined bride, an idea that informs the module throughout its long history with the epic. Violins fall in another arpeggio as she sobs Donner's name on a descending fifth. First clarinet joins first violins for another rising fryapulse, this time completed by two frantically ascending strophes
of its second module,
while on a pair of falling thirds, Freya begs her brother to come to her rescue. A harsh string woodwind crotchet chord silences the orchestra on the next downbeat, and a cappella Freya addresses her last plea to Fro on a pair of chord notes which parse as reverse melody notes, which she caps with reverse chord notes. Freya's pleas may seem like protracted bombast, yet they serve key narrative syntactic purposes. The first and most obvious is to irrevocably associate Freya with her signature morpheme by repeating it four times while she's in view and singing.
Her vocal syntax is attendantly sparse, but still enlightening. In its course, she sings three static ash intervals with their close relation to giant thumps, and all of six chord note pulses, low strings twice intoning air-to-melody cribs, each detail to emphasize her status as nature goddess. The plunging fifth, an octave, and tritone suggest her peril, while her two adaptions of Alberich's Lusting Tern, with its similarity to the giants, orchestrally echoes twice in quick succession after her second iteration, a detail to bear on her relationship with Fasolt. Her third bounces expand the idea of that cell as a mark of vitality, while her Welterb triad reverse melody notes and orchestral ring fragments hint at her racial peril, the bundle tied neatly with the reverse air-to-chord notes' sense of resistance.
Her distress, which in other hands might be disposed of with a line or two, stresses her helplessness, calling herself Die Schwache, information vital to understanding the plight of love in this first chapter of the epic, particularly since her cries don't immediately bring her siblings running. She also introduces the other gods and their relationships to her, calling Fricka her sister and Donner and Fro her brothers. This seemingly minor point has vast relevance to the story, since if Votan's trip to the World Ash nets him his consort and her sister, along with them and his spear, the god also captures the powers of the skies in Donner and Fro. Finally, there's the question of why Donner and Fro, who may be considered the brawn of the immortal bunch, remain so conspicuously absent in the hour of Freya's need. The Meister's stage instructions specify they're not to enter until their vocal parts begin, and some productions honor that request. But, possibly thanks to Chereau's innovations for the Bayreuth Centennial, the two younger male gods are often found on stage at the beginning of Scene 1, with Votan and Fricka. This may be a nod to contemporary realism, eschewing the old-fashioned melodrama of their precipitate entrances when the giants physically threaten Freya, but it has the unfortunate consequence of leaving them nothing to do for the scene's first minutes, except mug and dumb show, rustling about like dead leaves until the giants arrive, a chronic failing among operatic supernumeraries. Worse, once Fasolt and Fafnir appear, Donner and Fro can only seem weirdly useless until time for their vocals. Never mind this directly contradicts the lyrics, which imply they're too cowardly to come when Freya calls, it also has the equally negative effect of robbing Votan's distress of its focus, whose solitary dilemma by right should be foremost. Indeed, Fricka takes a final swing at the menfolk for hiding. Second violins, violas, thumping out a rising minor seventh arpeggio built from double semi-quaver crotchet impacts, each separated by a dotted quaver rest and underlined by cello minims. This touch, which itself develops into a kind of submorpheme, underlines the offbeat horn woodwind pulses, which earlier inform the first appearance of the Freya morpheme,
themselves foreshadowed in Alberich's Curse on Love,
a detail which over time acquires a potent sense of harshly negative resistance to all Votan's plans. the goddess consort's vocal outlines two rising triads, the first energized by a low ash interval, their sense of abandonment even more biting here. She caps the second with a dire falling fifth, then, with only pizzicato crotchet string punctuations, falls a plangent sixth, a chord note pulse, and a last descending fifth, all of them marks of despair. With that, the giants appear. And there we must leave it until the next video picks up where this one leaves off in Dover's full score on the first stave of page 99. As always, thanks for watching, and please do leave your comments. Time and energy allowing, I'll do everything I can to respond. Lastly, as all YouTubers know, your subscription to this channel by itself is a huge assist in completing this vast project. Hit the bell to be notified of the next videos. With luck and your support, there'll be a lot more to come.